Oh, it's so good to see you. And welcome also to people who are listening or watching us online. I'm Jenny Morgan, one of the co-pastors here. Thank you. And for today, I get to greet you again with the words of our ethos. Married, divorced, and single here. It's one family that mingles here. Conservative and liberal here. We've all got to give a little here. Big and small here, there's room for us all here. Doubt and believe here, we all can receive here. LGBTQ and straight here, there is no hate here. Woman and man here, everyone can here. Whatever your race here, for all of us grace here. In imitation of the ridiculous love Almighty God has for each of us and all of us, we live and love without labels. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, around here, we like to say, how we do what we do is as important as what we do. And we mean it. The importance of focusing on how we do what we do has led us to believe that health, the health of our church, is more important than the growth of our church. You know, healthy things grow naturally. Plants, flowers, babies, puppies, universes. Healthy things grow naturally. They can't help but grow. God causes that kind of growth, and we don't have to force growth as a church. But we do play a key role in becoming and being healthy. Our community covenant has been compiled by hundreds of us over the last 9 years. We update it almost every year. The covenant has become crucial to our leaders and many of our volunteers and many of you. It's not perfect, just like none of us are perfect. But if you were to pull the curtain back and try to find out what's going on behind the scenes at Highlands Church, you would find this covenant. It's our effort to make sure our relationships are becoming more and more healthy. How we do what we do is as important as what we do. So in your program, if you've got a program today, you'll have an insert that is our community covenant. And I want you to just look at it for a second. This is our relational commitments to each other and to God and to ourselves. This covenantal engine is made up of a complex network of relationships with one another, with God, and with ourselves. It can actually be boiled down to two words, love and trust. Loving and trusting God, loving and trusting each other, and loving and trusting ourselves as well. A covenant like this has been a part of our DNA since very much at the beginning of our church, because we realized that we needed to live by relational principles rather than laws or a list of rules. And the overarching pattern of the Bible is where this covenant originated. So just a couple quick examples. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. God said that through Moses early in the ancient Hebrew scriptures. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Jesus said something like that in all four of the Gospels. And then Paul, about halfway through the Christian scriptures, the New Testament, said this, "Owe no one anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. Love your neighbor as yourself." And then near the end of the New Testament, John writes this, "God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent God's only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that God loved us and sent his Son. If we love one another, God lives in us, and God's love is perfected in us. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. We love because Jesus first loved us. The commandment we have from Jesus is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. So love God and love your neighbor as you love yourself." This is the clarion call of the Hebrew scriptures and the Christian scriptures. It's this as yourself directive that's often neglected in churches. But we need to go there together today and for the next 5 weeks. And first, the bigger story is that we live for love because God loved us first. First and always, God loves us, so we love God and love each other, and we learn to love ourselves. It's in its most basic form, the covenant is really about imitating that kind of love, imitating the way we see God moving in the world around us. You'll remember the end of our ethos says, in imitation of the ridiculous love Almighty God has for each of us and all of us. So our community covenant helps us follow closely on the heels of Jesus. Here's how the scriptures summarize this. Watch what God does, and then you do it, like children who learn proper behavior from their parents. Mostly what God does is love you. Keep company with God and learn a life of love. Observe how Christ loved us. Christ's love was not cautious, but extravagant. Christ didn't love in order to get something from us, but to give everything of himself to us. Love like that. Agape love. It transcends all forms of human moral behaviors. The emphasis of our covenant is that kind of love, deep, abiding agape love. Agape love is always reaching out to us. Agape love always extends itself for us, no matter how lovable or unlovable we happen to feel. We can't make ourselves more lovable to God, and we can't make ourselves less lovable to God, though sometimes we try. Our connection to God is based on nothing other than God's choice to love us. Agape. It's rooted in Christ's freely giving himself to us to ensure us that we know how loved we are. We are beloved children of God. And since agape love is based on Christ loving us first, what that means is love really has the power to change us. It doesn't depend on us, but it can guide us into more love. So we're hoping as a community, and we're working toward a new kind of community with a particular way of living life together. This way is the way of love. And it means knowing how loved you are, and it also means knowing who you are, knowing your feelings, knowing your needs, knowing what your life is really all about. Our community covenant calls this self-awareness. So our growth in self-awareness is at the core of how we love. Before we go much further, I wanted to tell you about a conversation I had this week with Vanessa Bain. I asked Vanessa to tell me about cows. Right, C-O-W-S, cows. Vanessa likes cows. She grew up on a ranch, and she says cows are not at all self-aware, except that they know how to take care of their young, and they know what they need. Cows are simple creatures made by God, and cows do, in fact, bring glory to God, their creator. Cows act weird, however, when they have calves. When cows are pregnant, they have no community interaction and no personality. Apparently, they don't need a community covenant like we do. But once they start having babies, a switch turns on in those cow brains, and they become protective and aggressive. They can charge full cow speed at people and at vehicles. Vanessa told me that she once experienced a cow charging at her when she was driving a three-wheeler. These same cows have no problems with people or three-wheelers when they don't have babies. Here's the deal. Cows make God happy. Because God made cows, and somehow cows really, really are good at being cows. Humans aren't all that different in some ways. Cows bring glory to God by being cows, and just like we bring glory to God by being us, exactly us, with all our warts and awkwardness and quirks and oddities and all our beauty and all our awesomeness, just like cows. Cows are important to God. God cares about cows. But different than cows, humans are created in the divine likeness and image of the one who made them. We were created to love God and be loved by God, to serve and be served by Christ. We are here to experience God's pleasure of us, God's delight in us, and we do that by becoming more self-aware. Imitating God, imitating love means being more you, exactly you. Self-awareness is really focused on you. It's the process of knowing yourself well. Some of the work involves discovering what's underneath what you feel, what's underneath what you need, what drives you. Being self-aware is not the same as being self-consumed. It's not the same as being self-absorbed or self-centered. In fact, people who are in this process of becoming self-aware are often very humble people who freely give love to others, like we see Jesus doing. So for us, we expand our self-awareness by paying attention to what's going on inside, paying attention to how our inner thoughts and the stories we tell ourselves in our heads affect the world on the outside. Becoming self-aware is like an unraveling process. It's not easy. It does take work. But it's an unraveling process that leads us to our most authentic spiritual experiences. I had one of these unraveling experiences recently. Christy, who is my partner, looked at me from across the dinner table and did this. You can't see that from the back, but I'm furrowing my brow. So Christy literally just did this to me from across the table, mocking me, I admit. And I felt a surge of shame. What I wanted to say was, "You have a furrowed brow too." But I didn't. What I felt was, "Ah, crap, I've been caught again being too serious." She didn't feel shame toward me or about me. She was simply noticing my furrowed brow syndrome. And I found out after the first service that I'm not the only one who has that. So I feel a little less ashamed second service. In fact, Christy just laughed at me and said something like, "Smile at me for a second. Just smile at me for a second. Because when you smile, the furrowed brow goes away. And I feel like you have a furrowed brow more than you need to have right now." I felt exposed. I am kind of serious sometimes. That's me. Like, that is a part of me, thinking hard about how to solve problems, trying to listen really intently to people because I care, because I want to serve people. Like, it's me. I am a strategery person, and I hold a lot of it right here. I do carry more burdens than God sometimes asks of me, so I carry that right here too. But that furrowed brow person listens really, really well. She is strategic. She knows how to solve big problems with grace and tenderness. And some of those good things turn heavy in my furrowed brow. Well, the truth is, I want to be self-aware. I want to know what my insides look like on the outside in my face. Because it's not my face's problem that I have a furrowed brow, right? It's something on the inside that's doing that. And that furrowed brow also has a lot of good in it. But when I refuse to admit my anger or my fear or my hurts, when I can't name what's underneath those feelings and coming out in that furrowed brow, when I feel shame, shame that makes me want to hide, or when I give in to the impulse to try to accomplish more than I should, or try to be more perfect than I was ever made to be, or when I move at 100 miles an hour, all of those things make me less and less self-aware. Here's the good news. Self-awareness is all about me. It's all about you. And that kind of me focus is good and healthy when it looks like our community covenant. Our community covenant teaches us that being self-aware means, first and foremost, being present right now. So for me, That means less multitasking. It means less phone attachment, more here and now, physical, spiritual presence, more gentle breathing as a way to settle in and be okay with my heart, more smiling, more paying attention to what's going on inside of your life, more paying attention to your gifts and the skills you bring to the world and the good that you have to offer this hurting world. So our community covenant says, if you want to be self-aware, be more present and be more authentic. Being authentic helps us name our fears without letting our fears lead us. Because we are so loved, we have less to prove, we have less to win, and we have less to fight for. Think about it. The love that Christ gives us allows us to be less needing to prove ourselves, less needing to win, less needing to be right. So we can be more real right here and right now. That's being present and being authentic. The covenant teaches us both of those things. And it also says, if we want to be self-aware, we have to be clear about our intentions and about our expectations. Keep in mind, the focus is on you. Be aware, but not controlled by your intentions and your needs and your unmet expectations. My furrowed brow is teaching me a lot. Rather than feeling shame about that part of me, I'm trying to lean into it and learn what I can. Being truly aware of my own expectations is really vulnerable. Sometimes my furrowed brow is a reflection that I wish the person I was with, Christy, for example, would be more perfect, because then that'll make me feel safer. That'll make me feel somehow better about myself. But my needing that actually cuts me off from loving people and loving God and loving myself. And that unmet expectation, there's a lot of stuff underneath that. That expectation makes me less capable of loving people and loving God and loving myself. The easiest part of this self-awareness work involves being around people who are further along in the journey of becoming self-aware than we are. Most of my role models at this stage in my life are people who have worked hard and who keep working hard to become more self-aware. So what do Katie Cannon, Brené Brown, Mark Tidd, and Jesus have in common? Two of them are dead and two are alive. Two of them are white and two of them are dark-skinned. Two of them are men and two of them are women. What do they have in common? The first African-American woman ordained in the Presbyterian Church, she was a prominent 20th century theologian who expanded our view of God by listening well to the voices of the marginalized. Dr. Katie Cannon grew up under the burden of oppression and racism and injustice. Her early life experiences were characterized by being degraded as a black woman. But her suffering was transformed into clarity about who she is and about who God is to her. She grew up during a time when feminist theology dismissed black women and black liberation theology actually ignored the role and the voice of black women. It was a time, especially in the church and in theological circles, when women in general were silenced, dismissed, and denigrated. But her burden and her suffering became her pathway to self-awareness, and she changed the world. Dr. Cannon died late this past summer. But her journey of self-awareness and her theological discovery transformed the way many of us see God and see ourselves and see each other. She's one of my role models. Dr. Brené Brown, she is forming the way millions of people experience vulnerability as courage instead of shame. Her work helps us to see our community covenant as actually a list of vulnerability skills that we think everybody in the world can learn. She's teaching us to take risks, She's teaching us to own our role in our own problems, just like she had to do. Brené Brown had a season in her life where she lived recklessly and tried all sorts of things to make herself numb her feelings. And later on, when she did the bulk of her PhD research, Brené Brown had a bit of a breakdown when she discovered that vulnerability was actually the key to wholehearted living. Brené Brown's path to self-awareness took her through shame and vulnerability. She reminds us, the cave you fear to enter holds the treasure you seek. The cave we fear to enter holds the treasure we're seeking. We have to do this hard work of self-awareness because it will lead us to treasure chests of love. And what about Mark Titt? Yeah, that's a great picture of him, right? I think that deserves a little applause. Are you in here, Mark? There he is. Mark is quick to admit when he's wrong. Do you know how profound that is for a church leader? He is quick to forgive. He is quick to extend affection. And Mark is quick to speak the truth. Years of good therapy have led Mark down the path of self-awareness. Different therapists over different seasons of his life serving him so that he could face the things inside of him, the places where he felt stuck. Mark says therapy isn't one and done. Therapy isn't just one session or one therapist. It's there whenever we need it. Just like self-awareness is never done for us. God wired us to be becoming more and more of who God made us to be. Mark is like Dr. Cannon and Dr. Brené Brown because he's committed to becoming self-aware. These three role models of mine share self-awareness in common, and they also share self-awareness with Jesus. Jesus. I love this picture of Jesus. Because he's not a white guy, right? He's a Middle Eastern dark-skinned man, and no one really knows what he looked like. But popular mechanics like this picture. They found some research that advanced research in forensic studies, and this is what they came up with. Whatever, right? We don't know what he looks like. But what we do know is Jesus knew when to be kind and gentle and when to push really hard. Jesus knew when to lean into his enemies and when to lean into his friends. Jesus knew when to walk away. Jesus knew when he needed to center his heart and rest his soul. One story describes him this way. But now more than ever, the word about Jesus spread abroad. Many crowds would gather to hear him and to be cured of their diseases. But he would withdraw to deserted places and pray. Jesus knew who he was and what his mission was. He walked a self-awareness path by humbly setting aside all his rights as God and giving up everything for the sake of love, and then participating fully as one of us with one of us. He followed his self-awareness path by being with God frequently in silence and in solitude. He paid attention to the inside of his life. We can too. I think it helps to have role models to look at, to learn more about self-awareness. But we're mostly imitating what we see in Jesus when we say, as a church, we want to become more self-aware. And that imitation requires solitude and silence. As often as he possibly could, he withdrew to be alone with God. We need that too. Because together, we are trying to become more self-aware. The world changes for the better when we know ourselves better. Self-aware people actually gentle this turbulent world. And the fruit of self-awareness is always kindness. That's what these four people demonstrate over and over and over. It's more than kindness, right? But it is always kindness. I have actually come to believe recently that the work of self-awareness is one of the biggest reasons that this church exists in the world. Because I think self-aware people have the greatest chance of playing a role in changing the world. So dig in this year at Highlands Church. Take a risk. Do something you've never done before. Find a way to be involved here because this might be your pathway to self-awareness. It is mine. Dig into your relationships. Dig into your pain and your disappointment and your joy. Highlands Church really could be a path for you to become more self-aware. Whether it leads you through suffering, like Katie Cannon, whether it leads you through shame, like it did for Brené Brown, whether it leads you to therapy, like Mark Tidd, or whether it just leads you to more silence and solitude, like Jesus. However you get there, trust the Spirit to be kind and gentle. God wants to lead us into more and more love. God sees our furrowed brows, and God smiles. Henry Nouwen wrote, "The Spirit longs to guide us to places where the deepest desires of our heart can be fulfilled. But when we neglect the work of becoming more self-aware, we can't even really know what our deepest desires are." So the Spirit says, "Don't be afraid to let go. Let me fulfill the truest, deepest desire of your heart." Let's pray. Thank you, God, that we have this community to try to do some of this hard work together. Thank you that this hard work is way more than self-help, that this actually helps us to be more of who you want us to be so that we can receive more love and give more love. We want that as a community, God. So we pray for your help. We pray for your guidance. We pray that you would help us when those prickly moments come up and our furrowed brows are out in public and we feel exposed. Help us to be able to lean into that. So give us the grace to move through this, God. And we thank you, Jesus, that you walked this way before us. We want to follow you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.